My dear learners, for this course on turbo machines, in today's lecture we are beginning a new module, that is module 3, where in which we will be dealing with steam turbines. Steam turbines are nothing but an energy developing turbo machines in which the energy transfer takes place between the steam and the rotor due to the dynamic action of steam impinging on the rotors or blades of the turbines. This steam turbines are of two types. One is impulse steam turbine and reaction steam turbine. The flow of the steam might be axial or radial, but in our syllabus we will be studying only on axial flow steam turbines. Now, coming for the syllabus or theoretical concepts that one should know or thorough in this module, is that the first theoretical concept is that one should know the difference between impulse turbine and reaction turbine. Second important theory should be known as compounding and types of compounding. Then we will be discussing about maximum blade efficiency for impulse and reaction turbine, reaction steam turbines, that is 50% degree of reaction steam turbine, and we will be discussing about proof of for R is equal to 0.5, alpha 1 is equal to beta 2 and alpha 2 is equal to beta 1. And then we will be discussing problems on single stage steam turbine, and finally we will be discussing on multi-stage steam turbine problems. So in today's lecture, we will be discussing on difference between impulse and reaction steam turbines and need for compounding and types of compounding. In our next lecture, I will discuss or derive expressions for maximum blade efficiency of impulse and reaction steam turbines, that is 50% degree of reaction steam turbine. Later, I will derive or prove that for 50% degree of reaction, alpha 1 is equal to beta 2 and alpha 2 is equal to beta 1, which we are using since our module 2. And apart from these theory concepts, you should be able to conduct analysis of single stage steam turbines and multi stage steam turbines. Since we are studying about axial flow steam turbines, we will be solving problems graphically, because the analytical approach I have already taught you people clearly in our module 2. So if you want to solve problems analytically, you can refer lecture 8, 9 and 10 of our module 2, where in which I have explained how to solve axial flow turbines problems analytically. In this module, we will be conducting geometrical approach or graphical method of conducting analysis of steam turbines for both single stage as well as for multi stage. Graphical method of solving or conducting analysis of turbines can be conducted only for axial flow machines. Kindly make a note. Let us start discussing one by one. Coming for steam power plant, the steam power plant will be as shown in the figure. Initially, the steam will be generated in the boiler in two different pressures, that is low pressure boiler and high pressure boiler. The high pressure, high temperature steam will be passed through the nozzle, where it will gain velocity. This high velocity steam will be made impinge on the rotor vanes. Then the discharged steam will be made to pass through the condenser, where heat rejection takes place. Then the liquid is again pumped back to the boiler. Again, boiler generates steam and cycle repeats. In this module, we are concerned with turbine. That is, we should study how to analyze nozzle and rotor. A turbine consisting of both stator and rotor, the stator or stationary part is nothing but nozzle. So this is about steam power plant working. Our concern is this part, nozzle and rotor. Together we call it as turbine. As I said, the steam turbines are of two types. One is impulse, another one is reaction. Now coming for the difference between the impulse steam turbine and reaction steam turbine, as you observe, if you plot variation of pressure and velocity over the passage length of steam, we will observe the steam expands completely in the nozzle in case of impulse turbine, whereas steam expands partially in nozzle and remaining expansion takes place in the moving blades. When steam passes through the nozzle, since pressure drop is observed, the velocity will be increased. The exit of the nozzle is nothing but inlet for the moving blades or rotor, and the steam is made pass through the rotor, wherein which the steam loses its velocity. Now, for impulse turbine, if you observe the variation of pressure and velocity over the steam passage length, in the nozzle pressure drop is observed and velocity will be increased. In the moving blades, velocity will decrease, whereas pressure remains constant. Since pressure is constant, there is no change in enthalpy in the moving blade. The change in enthalpy observed only in the nozzle. That is, steam expands completely in the nozzle for impulse turbine. Whereas in case of reaction turbine, if I plot variation of velocity and pressure over the steam passage length, we can observe steam expands partially in the nozzle and remaining expansion takes place in the moving blade, whereas velocity will increase in the nozzle and decrease in the moving blade. In the next stage, if you consider, the stationary blades are nothing but the nozzles here for reaction turbine. Again, the velocity will increase, pressure will decrease. In the moving blades, velocity will decrease, pressure will also decrease. This is because of the reason, if you observe, the blades are symmetrical in case of impulse turbine, whereas the blades are aerofoil shaped in case of reaction turbine. So this is the difference between impulse turbine and reaction turbine. Now, if I recall or list the difference between impulse turbine and reaction turbine, the first one is the blades are symmetrical in case of impulse turbine, the blades are airfoil shaped in case of reaction turbine. The second important difference is that steam expands completely in the nozzle, steam expands partially in the nozzle in case of reaction turbine, and remaining expansion takes place in the moving blade. Third important difference is that the absolute velocity at the entry to the moving blades is very high in case of impulse turbine, whereas the absolute velocity of steam entering the moving blade will be relatively less compared to the impulse turbine. Coming for the fourth difference, the relative velocity, the component of relative velocity will remain same or equal in case of impulse turbine. Here in case of reaction turbine, the relative velocity components are not equal. Here, if there is no blade friction, that is K, which I have already discussed, if there is no blade friction, then VR1 is equal to VR2 in case of impulse, but here they are not equal because energy transfer is taking place in the moving blade also because of pressure drop. Next, if I write the energy supplied equation in case of impulse turbine, the fifth difference is energy supplied. For impulse turbine, the energy supplied is given by only the kinetic energy of steam at inlet, that is half mv square. So therefore, energy supplied per kg for impulse turbine is V1 square by 2GC, that's it. Whereas in case of reaction turbine, since pressure drop is observed both in the nozzle as well as in the moving blade, energy supplied per kg in case of reaction turbine is V1 square by 2GC plus VR2 square minus VR1 square by 2GC. Here itself we can say that VR1 is not equal to VR2 for reaction turbine. Next, coming for the sixth difference, the efficiency of impulse turbine is comparatively less, whereas the efficiency of reaction turbine is high. So these are the basic or major differences of impulse turbine and reaction turbine. If in case in examination, if it is asked to differentiate between impulse turbine and reaction turbine, you people should draw this diagram and list the differences what I have explained just now. By knowing the difference between the impulse turbine and reaction turbine, let us move for our second topic of discussion, that is need for compounding and types of compounding. Compounding is nothing but the multi-staging. Why compounding is necessary? If someone asks the question, the compounding is necessary in case of steam turbines because the absolute velocity of steam discharging velocity, that is V2, the discharge velocity of the steam in case of steam turbines are high. Therefore, the utilization is less if I go for single stage. As we all know that for utilization to be maximum, V2 should be minimum. V2 can be minimum if and only if V2 is equal to Vf. That is, if discharge velocity of the steam is axial, then only we will get that utilization will become maximum. So therefore, I should utilize the velocity of steam as much as possible. This can be made by using multi-stages. You know, to make utilization maximum, we will be using compounding. Compounding are nothing but multi-staging. If I give you an example, that let us consider a steam entering with a velocity, absolute velocity of 1000 meters per second here, that is here. Then if I see the discharge velocity V2 as 500 meters per second, then I have used only 500 meters per second of velocity of steam. Remaining 500 meters per second is waste. So therefore, I can put one more stage and make that 500 meters per second steam enter to the stage 2, and thereby the discharge velocity might be observed as 200 meters per second. If possible, let us send that 200 meters per second velocity of steam to the stage 3, and likewise I can make use of absolute velocity of steam, which is nothing but the kinetic energy present in the steam. So therefore, in order to make utilization maximum, we should go for compounding or multi-stage. Coming for different types of compounding, we can use velocity compounding or pressure compounding or pressure velocity compounding. The three major types of compounding are velocity compounding, pressure compounding and pressure velocity compounding. Let us discuss one by one. If I consider velocity compounding, in case of velocity compounding, we will be having symmetrical blading arrangement with nozzle and moving blade, stationary blade, moving blade, stationary blade, moving blade, like that. As we all know, in case of nozzle, the pressure drop is observed, whereas the increasing velocity is observed because of expansion. So at the exit of boiler is inlet for nozzle, you can observe here. Nozzle exit is inlet for, boiler exit is inlet for nozzle. Therefore, we have very high pressure coming out of the boiler and very low velocity. The velocity is nearly equal to zero. This velocity might be negligible. So therefore, I am indicating it as velocity at the exit of the boiler and pressure at the exit of the boiler. Now it will make pass through the nozzle. From the boiler, we will make it pass through the nozzle, where in which we will observe increasing velocity and decreasing pressure. Next, when steam moves over the symmetrical blade, pressure remains constant, whereas velocity will decrease because of dynamic action of energy transfer in the moving blade. And on the stationary blade, the velocity and pressure both remains constant. Again, in the moving blade, pressure remains constant, whereas velocity will be decreasing. So therefore, in case of velocity compounding, only pressure drop is observed in the nozzle and pressure remains same or constant throughout the stages, all the stages. Whereas coming for variation of velocity, velocity will increase in the nozzle, decrease in the moving blade, remains constant in the stationary blade. So stationary blade just guides the velocity of steam to the moving blades. This is about velocity compounding. As you observe, we are making the maximum utilization of steam. So this point is inlet for moving blade. So here we will be having velocity V1, absolute velocity of steam entering the rotor. You can observe here. So this is the velocity, almost it is nearly equal to zero, whereas here we have very high magnitude. So therefore, with multiple stages of stationary blade, moving blade, stationary blade, moving blade, we are making maximum utilization of steam velocity, that is kinetic energy of steam. This is about velocity compounding. Whereas if I come for pressure compounding, we will observe both velocity as well as pressure drop. That is, for pressure compounding, we will be having nozzle, moving blade, such arrangement. Here, as we know that when steam passes through the nozzle, pressure drop is observed and velocity will increase. On the moving blade, pressure remains constant because of symmetric blading arrangement. These blades are symmetric. On the symmetric blades, pressure won't change. Pressure change is observed if and only if we have airfoil shape. or nozzle. Next, on the moving bed, velocity will decrease. Again, in the nozzle, velocity increases, pressure decreases. In the moving bed, pressure remains constant, velocity will decrease. Like this, we'll make use of maximum extent of the kinetic energy present in the steam. So this is the working condition of pressure compounded steam turbines. We'll have alternate rows of nozzles and moving blades, or you can replace this nozzle by airfoiled shaped blades. Next, coming for pressure velocity compounding. Pressure velocity compounding is so simple, right? Velocity compounded steam turbines twice. Take nozzle, moving blade and stationary blade, rate it once. Again you take nozzle, moving blade, stationary blade, rate it again. So once I wrote nozzle, moving blade and stationary blade of a velocity compounded steam turbine, again I repeated it. So you know how it works. First half is the velocity compounded. Since we are placing nozzle after the stationary blade, velocity will again increase and pressure will decrease. So therefore we are compounding for pressure here. So here we are compounding for pressure. Whereas here velocity is compounded, here also velocity is compounded. In order to compound for pressure, we are introducing the nozzle after the first set of velocity compounded steam turbines. So if I write nozzle, moving blade and stationary blade one set twice, I will get the pressure velocity compounded steam turbine. So for pressure velocity compounded steam turbines, you should have nozzle, moving blade, stationary blade, and then again nozzle, moving blade, stationary blade. If the blades are symmetric, then in the moving blades velocity will decrease and pressure remains constant. In case of symmetrical blades of stationary blades, both velocity as well as pressure remains constant. You can see here symmetrical blades. In the moving blades velocity decreases, pressure remains constant. In the stationary blade, both velocity as well as pressure remains constant. Only if you have nozzle or aerofoil shaped blading arrangement, then only we will observe increasing velocity and decreasing pressure, like here. Aerofoil stationary blade, we are observing increasing velocity, decreasing pressure. So this stationary aerofoil shaped blades acts as nozzle, whereas aerofoil shaped moving blades, we observe both drop in pressure as well as velocity. This reaction turbine diagram what I have shown can also be written for impulse reaction turbine. If he asks to explain impulse reaction turbine, then you can represent this. If I write only nozzle and moving blade and show variation of pressure throughout, increasing velocity and decreasing velocity, then it will become reaction turbine. For better understanding, I am showing multiple stages. So this diagram is also an explanation for impulse reaction steam turbine. So this is also our impulse reaction turbine. This is because I am showing multiple rows of stationary and moving blades. Keep that in mind. Whenever you speak about reaction turbines, the blade should be of aerofoil shape. Whenever you speak about impulse turbine, the blade should be symmetric. So this is about compounding and different types of compounding. In case of velocity compounding, we will compound only for velocity. In case of pressure compounding, if you observe, velocity will increase, decrease, increase and decrease. So therefore, in the multiple stages, only we will observe compounding of pressure. But in case of pressure velocity compounding, at the end, if you observe, both velocity as well as pressure will be decreased. So with this very brief introduction to difference between impulse and reaction steam turbine, need for compounding and types of compounding, let us discuss nozzle, a very important part which is required for you people, because there are problems on nozzle also. And I explain how to draw combined velocity triangle, which is must, without which we cannot solve problems graphically. So let me pause this video for a while so that you people can copy it down. Later we'll discuss analysis of nozzle and how to draw combined velocity triangle and how to make use of it to solve problems graphically. Now coming for nozzles used in steam turbines, either I can have convergent nozzle or I can have convergent divergent nozzle. Whenever you draw nozzle, always try to have an habit of hatching it, which means that the nozzle is stationary. I'll tell you why. So this is convergent type nozzle, or I can also use convergent divergent nozzle. Why I am hatching it and showing it as a stationary is because whatever flow happens inside a nozzle is because of pressure difference. It is a pressure driven flow. If you won't hatch it, then it might be velocity driven flow or pressure driven flow. You might get confused. What I mean to say is that let us consider a river. Water inside a river is flowing with certain velocity. If I throw a plate onto the river, the plate will also move along with the water. This is because of the reason the water below the plate is moving, so therefore it is dragging the plate with it. That is known as velocity driven flow. But here the nozzle will not move and take the steam inside it. Nozzle will remain stationary. Only steam will gain velocity when it passes over the nozzle. So this type is known as pressure driven flow. When I hatch it, this is stationary. The flow is because of pressure difference. If I won't hatch it, it means it is a velocity driven flow, or there might be ambiguity whether it is pressure driven flow or velocity driven flow. So therefore always make a habit that whenever you show nozzle, always hatch the surface, which indicates that nozzle is stationary and flow is because of pressure difference. Now if I apply steady state steady flow energy equation, applying steady state steady flow energy equation from first law of thermodynamics, I can write enthalpy at the inlet of the nozzle plus velocity at the inlet of the nozzle square by 2 times GC. The magnitude of GC is 1 plus the datum. Datum is, let us take it as Z at inlet divided by GC. This must be equal to H at exit plus velocity at the exit of the nozzle square by 2 GC, not G, because we are writing it in joules per kg, plus we have Z at exit into acceleration due to gravity divided by GC into acceleration due to gravity should be multiplied. Whether if you use GC here, it doesn't make any difference. No, if you use GC, then only we will get joules per kg. So this is the exact expression we will get. Both in the LHS and RHS, we have the unit joules per kg, if you observe. Now, from the analysis, the datum is same, that is, inlet is equal to exit. So therefore, I can cancel off these two. And at the inlet of the nozzle, velocity of the steam is negligible, so therefore Vi is equal to 0. Inlet of nozzle velocity is negligible. So now if I simplify further, I will get enthalpy at inlet of the nozzle plus 0 is equal to enthalpy at the exit of the nozzle plus velocity at the exit of the nozzle square divided by 2gc. Very important, this is not g. Z into g, 9.81 meter per second square. This is gc. Gc is 1 kg meter per newton second square, which you people already know, which I explained in our lecture 1 of module 2. Now, I can find the exit velocity of the nozzle. So, velocity at the exit of the nozzle is equal to enthalpy at the inlet of the nozzle minus enthalpy at the exit of the nozzle multiplied by 2 under the root. So, this is because of the reason value of Gc is 1 kg meter per newton second square. What is velocity at the exit of the nozzle? Is nothing but absolute velocity of the steam entering the rotor. So this is nothing but V1. So therefore, whenever you solve problems on nozzle, the absolute velocity of steam entering the stage should be calculated by using the formula square root of 2 into enthalpy at inlet minus enthalpy at exit. Now the question is whether this change in enthalpy is isentropic or anisentropic. We, for theoretical analysis, we assume that the expansion inside the nozzle is isentropic expansion, but in actual working case, it is not isentropic. So therefore, with the help of Mollier chart, if I use and plot the variation of enthalpy for an nozzle, let us say we have inlet pressure like this. This is pressure at inlet of the nozzle, this is pressure at exit of the nozzle. Since expansion is taking place, pressure drop is observed. We have enthalpy versus entropy, which is chart. Now, theoretical assumption is that, let us say it is dry saturated. For our assumption, that we assume it is dry saturated at the entry of the nozzle, the steam is dry saturated. So therefore, this is entry point 1. Actually, we assume it has an isentropic expansion. So take entropy constant, we will get state point 2. But what actually taking place is anisentropic expansion, like this, the actual expansion takes place. So this is the actual happening. This is what we are assuming. 1 to 2 dash isentropic is what we are assuming, but actually happening is 1 to 2. So therefore, I want 1 to 2, which can be determined by using nozzle efficiency. Efficiency of nozzle is defined as actual enthalpy drop. Actual enthalpy drop divided by isentropic enthalpy drop. Isentropic enthalpy drop. So therefore, if I know nozzle efficiency, actual enthalpy drop, here I wrote twice, actual enthalpy drop is H1 minus H2 divided by isentropic H1 minus H2 dash. This H1 minus H2 dash I can calculate by using, and I can find H1 and H2 dash if I know pressure, and if it is dry saturated I can find. Now I want actual enthalpy drop, so therefore actual enthalpy drop is delta H actual is equal to efficiency of the nozzle into isentropic enthalpy drop, H1 minus H2 dash. It is isentropic. So therefore, for HI minus H exit, that is for HI minus H exit, from the Mollier chart, with the help of Mollier chart, I should find, which is nothing but efficiency of the nozzle into delta H isentropic. So using Mollier chart, you should find isentropic enthalpy change. They should give you the nozzle efficiency. Then you can find what is the actual enthalpy drop. Using actual enthalpy drop multiplied by 2 under the root, you will get the entry velocity of the steam to the rotor. Let me pause this video for a while so that people can note it down. Next, I will explain how to use combined velocity triangle for analysis of steam turbines. Now, coming for combined velocity triangle for conducting analysis of steam turbines, let us recall the general velocity triangle first. The general velocity triangle for turbines is already known to you people very well. And in that, we will be having Vf and we might be having Vr1, V1, Beta1, Alpha1 from absolute is the reference, absolute relative is U1, absolute flow is tangential component of absolute velocity Vu1. Similarly at exit of the blade, very important, exit of rotor, if you draw, you will have Vr2, V2, Vf2. Absolute is the reference, absolute relative is U2, absolute flow is Vu2. This is alpha2 and this is beta2. Coming for the base, the direction will be like this and Vu2 direction will be like this. U2 should move in the same direction as U1. This you already know. So this is general velocity triangle for power developing turbo machines, that is for turbines. Now for steam turbines, we analyze axial flow steam turbines only in our syllabus. So therefore, whenever you see the word steam enters the rotor, default you can take axial flow U1 is equal to U2 is equal to U. So for axial flow, we will be having U1 is equal to U2 is equal to U. Hence, for graphical method, we should always use combined velocity triangle. Now U is common, so therefore draw the common base U. We have common base U. Now draw the mirror image of inlet velocity triangle. So draw the mirror image of inlet velocity triangle and you get V1, alpha1 and Vr1, beta1. Now if I drop the perpendicular from the tip, I will get the flow velocity. So this should be vertical length, Vf1. Now again, you draw the mirror image of exit such that U2 should coincide on U, because U1 is equal to U2 is equal to U. So if I draw like that, I will get Vr2 at exit. So this should be Vr2. Use same color for relative velocity, that is green. So therefore, angle made by Vr2 is beta2. So this is Vr2. Then we have V2. Angle made by V2 is alpha2. Now if I drop the perpendicular, I will get Vf2. Absolute is the reference. Absolute flow is Vu2. Direction is opposite to Vu1. Absolute flow is
we do one act in that direction is opposite to we do.
So this is the combined velocity triangle. One should know to conduct analysis of steam turbines using graphical method. So people should remember this velocity triangle. Throughout this module, they will be using this velocity triangle. If discharge is axial, then Vf is equal to V2. So this will come here. We will have only Vr to join in. So vertical line Vf is equal to V2. Alpha to become 9 degrees. Any alteration specified, we can make it to this combined velocity triangle. This combined velocity triangle is must to solve problems graphically. With this very brief introduction to steam turbines, in our next lecture, I will derive maximum blade efficiency expressions for impulse turbine and reaction turbine. That's all from this lecture. Thank you all.